material to you. Safe and Wise Advisory Limited is well-established financial planning and risk advisory firm of the country with nationwide presence. SWL is engaged in selling third-party products, be it financial product or insurance product, life insurance only. Financial product is basically your mutual fund shares, all of that. Financial advisory business of SWL is doing well and contributing to half of revenue, two-thirds of bottom line. Bottom line means profit, but insurance is not performing as per expectation. Independent and impartial advice to client is unique selling point of SWL. I have two businesses. One is financial product business. Second is insurance product business. Financial product is doing well, contributes to half of revenue, two-thirds of profits. Insurance business is not performing well. It will also be half of revenue, but one-third of profits. Half of revenue and one-third of profits. Their bottom line or their unique selling point is independent and impartial advice. Independent and impartial advice to client is the unique selling point of SWAL. Independent and impartial advice is what they give. SWAL was established by Mr. Kaushal Jaiswal around 2 decades ago when life assurance business goes private. At then it was one division business, assurance brokerage business. Mr. Kaushal Jaiswal is dynamic leader and presently leading the company as CEO, apart from being major shareholder of the company. So maybe I'll just little bit talk about the two businesses. The two businesses, one is financial product business and second is insurance product business. What is financial product businesses? Some clients will go to this SWAL. They will tell, please buy these shares, please buy these mutual funds, invest in these fixed deposits. To give that advisory, they can charge the client. They can also get some commission from the mutual fund or from the banks if they're referring the fixed deposit. So that's called your financial advisory business. Insurances, they make their clients get insurance. Once they get life insurance, LIC, your life insurance is taken, LIC or your private insurer will be paying some commission, will be paying some commission to the agents. This was formed by Mr. Kaushal Jaiswal. SWL is widely acknowledged in market for two distinct features. First being presence wide across the nation, so they are available in almost everywhere in the form of sub-agency offices equipped with professionally trained staff headed by financial planner or advisor, where customer can take advice and discuss opinion prior to investing or buying any insurance or financial product. SWAL has sub-agency office in 580 cities, towns and blocks. Locations are semi-commercial in nature but prominent. SW has practiced to sign 30-year lease whensoever taking and sub-agency office on lease in order to reduce the lease cost and bring stability. So one of their unique selling point is they are almost available everywhere. They are available in the form of sub-agency offices. In that, you will have a financial planner or an advisor. Customer will go take advice and make the investments. Either they take an insurance or a financial product. They have this offices in 580 cities. They normally take a 30-year lease agreement. They normally take a 30-year lease agreement. Secondly, SWL sold product of all third parties, hence provide a range of product to its clients. So variety is also there to choose. In 2010, SWL signed a 15-year agency agreement. In 2010, we are in 2021. In 2010, SWL signed a 15-year agency agreement with all 23 life insurance companies recognized then. SWL's tagline is also depicting the same. We are ethically committed to understand and deliver your needs. SWL believes in organic growth and listed on stock market 3 years back to float additional capital to fund more sub-agency offices. So what they are saying is simple. I have two unique selling points. One is, I am available almost everywhere in the country, 580 offices, 580 cities I have. And second part is, I almost have agreement with all the insurance companies. I've been selling product of all insurance company. 22 out of these 23 life assurance companies are private and registered themselves with regulatory between 2000 and 2009 for a period of 25 years. Considering the default by few insurance firm and increasing customer complaints, regulator has tightened the registration criteria and hardened the norms. Getting an insurance license is not a simple thing. It's a very difficult thing. You have insurance regulatory authority. They will ensure that in the end, the policy holder is not at a disadvantage, because I am going to take an insurance policy today, life insurance policy. The claim of this could be after, if some event happens, or at the end of 25 years or 30 years. I need certainty that this insurance company will be in a solvent position for 25, 30 years. So there are a lot of restrictions on insurance companies by IRDA. Typically, each of sub-agency office comprise three regular and one contractual employee, one being financial planner or advice, two sales and relationship officer and contractual worker in role of support staff and vested with miscellaneous clerical responsibility. On-roll number of employees engaged in assurance brokerage business has been increased to 1564 from 725 years ago. So the number of employees have been going up from 720, it has gone up to 1564. Market trend is changing since the SWL commenced the business. Each of such insurance company now has their own network of branch offices to sell their insurance product directly, that to a more prominent location. SWL counters by highlighting its independence and impartial advice practice. Although SWL managed to retain the revenue, but this result in lower profitability. Now these new insurance companies are not authorizing any new agent. So now what is happening is, I was agent of an insurance company, but now this insurance company itself are setting up their offices and they are trying to sell their insurance product directly. So I am now required to compete with the insurance company itself. I am required to compete with the insurance company itself. I am their agent, but I am now required to compete with the insurance company itself. But I keep telling clients that I provide an impartial advice. But if you go directly to the insurance company, they will tell them to take their product only. Being in service industry and further in order to secure wider market reach to compensate the loss of profitability, SW established e-platform policy at YouClick to sell the insurance product with total staff of 50 professional as a separate division under insurance brokerage from sub-agency office division. E-platform division is prospering, but sub-agency office is certainly in trouble. So I have also now started doing e-sales. These are some of the market data point. These are some of the revenue data point for sub-agency and e-platform business. Data on the profitability, revenues, PBIT, shareholder equity, long-term debt, current liability, applicable tax rate. But the CEO has not agreed to the suggestion made by strategic planning committee, because he is of belief that SWL USP or original business is sub-agency office through which they ensure impartial and independence and impartial advance. In next board meeting, board is expected to pass resolution on the agenda item whether to continue or sell the sub-agency office division. Continue or sell the sub-agency office division. Why? Because this is not doing well. Assess the competitive environment of life assurance business. How can you assess the competitive environment? What technique do we use for assessing the competitive environment? There is a model we use. Which model is used to assess the competitive environment? Which model is used to assess the competitive environment or the competitiveness of the industry? Friends, you know it. Which model do you use to assess the competitive? Yeah. Porter's five forces model. Again, I'll tell you one more thing. It'll take time. It'll take, as you read more and more case studies, it'll take time. And if you read more case studies, there's nothing to remember in case studies. It's just that you'll have to read more and more. You'll have to keep reading more and more. Evaluate the case for holding the sub-agency division backed by financial viability among other criteria. The other part, there are two things they want. One is Porter's five forces model of life assurance business. Second, they are saying, should the sub-agency office division continue or close is a decision they have to take. They are saying, why should it be held back? Why should it be held back? Please give financial viability and also certain other criteria. Financial analysis as well as other analysis needs to be done. I'm giving you a little bit of time to read the case study. It's a very lengthy case study. Maybe 3-4 minutes to read the case study. Please take your time. I'll be back. Okay, I'll first quickly summarize the case study. SWL is into two business: financial insurance, financial advisory business, insurance life assurance business. Then I'll go through the PPT mode. Financial advisory, life assurance. So these are the two businesses they have. Just give me a minute. So financial advisory, this contribute 50% of revenues, 2/3 of profits. No issues with this. So I'm not going to analyze this. Let's ignore this as of now. Second is your insurance business. Again, it will have balance 50% of revenues, but only 1/3 of profits. Profits have been coming down. Profits have been coming down. That's the problem statement. The problem statement is made in the question in the initial paragraph itself. Profits have been coming down. Insurance brokerage business is not performing as per expectation. They have an USP called as independent and impartial advice. This para, I don't see anything great to be there. Mr. Kaushal Jaiswal is just a background. I have two unique selling points. One is sub-agency office in 580 cities. Sub-agency office in 580 cities. Insurance product of almost all insurers. Insurance product of almost all insurers are there. And USP's impartial advice. Impartial advice is their USP. Also, they go on something called as some 15-year agency. Yeah, there is a 15-year agreement with insurance companies, and there is a 30-year agreement with landlords. This is for taking your offices on rent. 22 out of 23 insurance companies are private. All that is fine. One important information I get to see is no new insurance companies will come. This will help me in doing Porter's five forces analysis, and no new agency as well. No new insurance companies and no new agency as well. Number of employees have grown up significantly. Recently, I've introduced an E division as well. E division. And if I look at this, I find that this will give me my share. So my share is broadly 280 divided by 1960. I had 14% share this time, 14.29%. And today, 326 by 2240. I have again broadly the same share. 14.55%. So I continue to hold on to my share. This industry from 1960 has gone up to 2240 in 4 years. 1960 to 2240. 2240 divided by 1960. The industry over a period of 4 years has grown by 14%, broadly around 3 to 3.5% every year. The industry is growing at a very low pace, around 3%. In fact, okay, I'll explain CAGR calculation sometime. Major chunk of business is through sub-agency. This also has one unique thing if you observe this carefully. E-platform is used only by 30 to 40 and 20 to 30. Sub-agency is limited and e-platform is higher. But as the age goes up, people are preferring, the older set of people are preferring to use sub-agency division and not preferring to use e-platform division, which is logical, which is very much logical. They will not be in a position to use this, they will not be more well-versed with the technology, so they are preferring to use the sub-agency office division. Your profitability has been declining, which is being shown here. 31 becoming 16, becoming 18. 31 becoming 16, becoming 18. This is in some crores.
So 31,000 crores, I think, whatever it is in crores. 31 has become 16, 16 has become 18. This talks about the debt part of it and talks about the current assets and current liability part of it. I have to do a competitive environment analysis of life assurance business of SWL and also the sub agency office and comment whether there is may it does it make any sense for me to close down this business or not. Now, let's first assess the competitive environment. We'll assess the competitive environment. This will obviously be done through Porter's five forces model. Your competitive environment analysis will be done through Porter's five forces model. We have bargaining power of suppliers, bargaining power of customers, substitutes being there, intensity of competition and new competition. When it comes to bargaining power of suppliers, I had explained when I did the summary. These are the factors we look at. Just give me a minute. We look at very few suppliers or more suppliers. Raw material is critical, not critical. Raw material doesn't come. Availability of any alternate option. Availability of any alternate option. For bargaining power of buyers, very few buyers or more buyers. Low cost of switching by suppliers. Threat of substitutes, multiple, not multiple. Barriers to entry, high profitability, high growth potential, and high number of firms. These are what the factors we were looking at. The first one is bargaining power of supplier. This is influenced by the number of supplier. Insurance company, neither it is high nor low. Neither it is high nor low. But there's one problem. There's one problem. The insurance companies are now trying to forward integrate. Insurance companies are now trying to forward integrate. What is forward integrate? They are setting up their own branch offices and want to directly sell to the end customer. If this strategy of insurance companies starts succeeding, then there is a problem for companies like SWAL. Then there is problem for companies like SWL because if insurance companies start directly selling, the bargaining power of insurance companies will be stronger when they discuss with companies like SWL. When they discuss with companies like SWL. So number of suppliers is not a problem. Insurance companies to forward integrate is there. This product is also important to me. Not very important, but it is important. See, why importance is tested? If the product is very important, no? Then indirectly I will be put into a weaker position because for me this product is very very critical that I cannot lose it. If I have that pressure whenever I'm doing any negotiation, I'll be on a weaker footing. So importance of product, allied product as financial advisory business contribute 50% of revenues and 2/3 of margin. Though it is allied, but it's still, it's a one of the critical product because 50% of revenue and 1/3 of margin. Possibility of substitution among insurance companies. You can substitute or you can move from one insurance company to another insurance company, and there are certain other factors also to be taken. My supplier is not only the insurance company, they are saying my supplier is also the landlord. Because he is one of the supplier, he is providing me the infrastructure. There are two suppliers. One supplier is providing me the insurance product. Another supplier is providing me the infrastructure, which is the rent. Good part about is I have taken it on lease for a longer period of time. So this landlord cannot come in between and start negotiating something. So from a bargaining power of suppliers, there are few good things. Good things is I've already entered into a longer agreement with landlord. I am having large number of suppliers, 23, which is neither high nor low. This product is important, but not very critical because it contributes 1/3, but still it's an important product for me. Another thing is if some insurance player is talking a lot, is negotiating a lot, I can move to another insurance company. I can start moving to another insurance company. One pain point for me is there is a possibility of forward integration. Next comes bargaining power of customers. Bargaining power of customers. Now, in a practical world, though I have a large number of customers, but it is easy for a customer to keep switching before he takes a policy. Before I take a policy, for example, I'll go to Policy Bazaar and search for life insurance option. I'll get so many options. I will compare one insurance with another insurance, and because of this comparison, I am able to negotiate for better premium. But once the policy is taken, you are kind of attached to that insurance company. You may have to continuously renew with that only. There are certain options called as insurance portability. I'm not sure whether it has come in the market or not, but that portability and all, if it come like mobile number portability, insurance portability can come into picture. If that comes, then customer can again enjoy a little bit of a benefit. But otherwise, customer, once they have taken a policy, they will not have flexibility. But before the policy is taken, there is going to be a lot of flexibility. The next part is on substitution. I don't think so any other product can serve the function of life insurance. There's no other product which can do the function of life insurance. So somewhere this issue is limited. This issue I don't see much. Threat of new entrant. This is a big advantage for me. Less number of new life insurance licensee by regulator due to tough regulation. Regulations have said, I am not going to allow people. New insurance agents are also not going to come. And even if the new people are going to come, they need the scale benefit. They cannot suddenly open 580 branches and all. So this is one good thing. The other two were kind of moderate. Threat of substitution is not there. Competitive rivalry is a problem. This is a problem. It is depend on number of competitors and market size. I hold a market share of 14.55%. How 14.55 was? I calculated my revenues as a percentage of size. Then market growth. I'll talk about this market growth. Give me a minute. You can write this. How CAGR is calculated? Please write this. This may be needed to answer the case study, because somewhere they will talk about certain CAGR numbers. How CAGR is calculated? Revenues in 2015-16. I'm talking about the industry growth, 1960. Revenues in 2015-16, 1960. Revenues in 2019-20, 2240. 1960 has become 2240 in another 4 years. Totally it's a 5 year, but in another 4 years it has become 2240 from 1960. From 1960 it has become 2240 in 4 years. 2240 in 4 years. A is equal to P into 1 plus R the whole power N. Basically this is your compound interest formula. The future value is 2240. Present value is 1960 into 1 plus R power 4. If it's power 4, power 8, power 2 and all, you can do in calculator. Otherwise, you need Excel. So that is a challenge you can have. 2240 divided by 1960. 2240 divided by 1960 is 1.1429. 1 plus R power 4, take a square root again, 1 plus R is equal to 1.0339, growth is 3.39%. This was 4 years, I could calculate it. 5, 6, 7, it cannot be possible, can't do much about it. If let's assume if it's 7-8 years, if it's 6 years, 7 years and all, your approximate answer is 14.29% for 4 years. This is approximate answer. 14.29 for 4 years. If you divide by 4, approx answer is 3.5%. You can say approximately the growth will be 3.5%. If it was not 4 years, if it was less than 5 years, 6 years, calculator cannot help for 5 and 6 years and all. So 3.39% is the CAGR, which is a very slow growth, So you are growing at a very slow rate. Also, there are certain exit barriers. It is good to have entry barriers. It is bad to have exit barriers. Why it is bad to have exit barriers? If there are exit barriers, let's assume BA is suffering in the market. BA is suffering. They are not doing well. And there are other competitors also not doing well. But nobody will move out of the industry. And will continue to suffer and make others also suffer. They will continue to be there in the industry. Why they are not exiting? You have a lease arrangement for 30 years. You have an agency agreement for 15 years. This is not still over. So entry barriers is good, but exit barriers is bad. If you have exit barriers, a weakly performing company will continue to be there in the industry, will suffer and make others also suffer. Suddenly, Reliance Communication moved out of the market. It was suffering, it moved out of the market. If it was suffering and it doesn't move out of the market, one, its profitability gets impacted. It will also impact the profitability of others in the industry. So whenever people are not performing well, if they are moving out, it is beneficial not only for them, it's also beneficial for the other players. Any doubts in this? So this is as far as your Porter's five forces is concerned. Now the second part is they are saying, why should you hold back sub-agency division? I have to talk from financial point of view as well as from non-financial point of view. The question was very clear. Please give me financial points as well as non-financial points. Holding backed by financial viability among other criteria. Financial viability as well as the other criteria needs to be seen. So I'll have to talk about both the points and say, why should I continue with sub-agency division? From a financial point of view, let's talk about financial, which is very objective in nature. Financial point of view, it contributes 1/3 of revenue, 50% of revenue, 1/3 of profits. 50% of revenues, 1/3 of profits, though profit is less. But still it contributes to 1/3 of profit and 50% of revenue. That's point number one. If you suddenly close down this business, the sub-agency part, not the entire business, if you suddenly close down this, sub-agency in fact contributes 280 out of 326. Sub-agency's contribution is 280 out of 326. Sub-agency basically contributes to 86% of the assurance business. So it's a significant contributor. I'm talking about only financial analysis as of now. I'll come to the non-financial factor. 86% of the insurance business comes from sub-agency and you want to close it. That's one issue. Second, revenues have been growing. Costs have been coming down. Sorry, your profits have been coming down. So profitability is impacted. But they are saying at least it is still making positive EBITDA. It is still making positive margins. It is making low margin. But it's not a loss-making business. So why do you want to close down? We calculate something called as operating margin. You would have learned this in ratio analysis. Operating margin is EBIT by revenue. 31 divided by 250, the operating margin was 12%. Has come down to 18 by 280. So the operating margin has come down. I'm not saying no to it. What is operating margin? EBIT by revenues. Operating margin has come down. But it's still positive. Also, there is some turnaround.
your overall EBITDA is also moving up. EBITDA from 16 has gone up to 18. One, it is positive. Second, it is moving up. Also, if I look at another return called as ROCE, you will learn this later on. You would have seen it in ratio analysis, which is called EBIT by capital employed, ROCE. EBIT, capital employed is this two put together, EBIT by capital employed. Again, in this ratio also, I will see weakening happening. Other financial ratios, if I see, debt by equity is 50 by 150.33. Going up to 78 by 156 to 0.5. 0.33 to 0.5. It is increasing, but still it is reasonable. Debt equity ratio of 0.5 is reasonable. Current assets by current liability ratio should also be okay, decent. It should be decent. Current assets by current liability. So these are the financial points which are there. One, it contributes to 1/3 of the overall, it contributes to 85% of life assurance business. Revenues have been growing. Profitability margin is declining, but still it is positive. In fact, in the last 2 years, overall absolute profits have gone up. ROC is declining, but still it is favorable. Gearing debt equity ratio is reasonable. Current ratio is reasonable. Contribution to the group. Insurance business is contributing 50% of revenue, 1/3 of profits, 86% of profit come from sub-agency. Profitability shrinking. What is operating margin is EBIT by sales. Is shrinking, however it is positive, showing improvement. ROC is EBIT by capital employed. Current ratio is stable. Gearing has increased but still remained comfortable. So somewhere these points are talking about why financially you should continue. There are also certain non-financial factors, certain non-financial factor. One, you have entered into an agreement with your landlord. So if you close down sub-agency offices now, you may have to pay penalty. You may have to pay penalty to the landlord. So that is one issue for me. Because I entered into an agreement for a period of, somewhere the question said that the agreement was for a period of 30 years or something. You entered into an agreement for 30 year lease. So I'm not sure whether these contracts are over, not over. You also entered into an agreement for 15 year agency agreement with your insurers. Agency agreement is not a problem. You can continue with online model, but this 30 year lease is a problem. Second issue. You have 1,564 employees in sub-agency office. You have 1,564 employees in sub-agency office. When you close it, you can shift them to e-platform. But the problem is it cannot absorb 1,564 employees. It can absorb some employees, but it cannot absorb 1,564 employees. So there is going to be a huge resistance from employees. Looking at this data point, can you tell me what point will you write why sub-agency should not be closed? What will you say looking at this table? I want you to tell this. Why should you not close sub-agency looking at this table? Why should we not close sub-agency looking at this table? Try. It's more of common sense. That's all. I'm not trying to bring in any technical points and all. Looking at this table, why should you not close at sub-agency?
Sir, it contributes a major part of my business.
Okay, that is financial. Apart from that, 86% is fine. This table gives... Yeah.
So 50 to 60 age people are under this category.
Correct. Looking at this table, you look at the disparity which is there, and it clearly brings in, see, one, my major revenue is coming from 50 to 60 and 60 plus, and these people are not ready to move to the e-platform. these people are not ready to move to the e-platform, and which is very much logical. If I'm trying to push my technology to my parents, they find it a little difficult to get used to the technology part. We are able to get used to the technology as of now easily. So this 50 to 60 and 60 plus set of people would want to go to a office, sit opposite to you, fill in some paper form, and then get the insurance done. If you are telling them to do it in an online mode, they may not want to do it. Also, we had an USP called as independent and impartial advice. This independent and impartial advice and all is not very much possible in an online model, because in an online model, I don't know whom I will talk to. I cannot talk to people in an online model. So client demographics, major clients are in 50% bracket and revenues from them is 99% through sub-agency. So please don't close it, because major clients are in 50% plus bracket. Resistance from employees, only 50 out of 1564 are in e-platform division. Hence restructuring may lead to resistance from employees. Legal issues, additional financial burden in pre-closing leases, as leases have not been fully completed. Losing USP, independent and impartial advice, this USP can be lost. Life insurance market has matured, low growth, low profitability, but sub-agency is contributing positive numbers, hence sale is not advisable, and it will impact both revenues, profitability, and host of other factors. It will impact a lot of other factors as well.